Like any other activity of creation, writing code requires certain tools. But as I explained earlier, JavaScript is an interpreted language, not a compiled one. So you're not going to need any special compilers or linkers or other complex tools. All you really need is a text editor and a browser. And I know for certain you have both of these on your computer. A Mac comes with TextEdit and Safari pre-installed, and Windows has Notepad and Internet Explorer. But most likely you're going to want to upgrade both of those and expand on them. First of all, you're probably going to want a text editor that's specifically designed for writing code. These give you all kinds of neat features like colored syntax highlighting, code completion, code templates and snippets, and project management. There are many of these available on every platform, and I'm not going to go through all the possible choices. If you are already doing some kind of HTML and CSS work, you most likely already have some kind of editor that you're comfortable with. If this is designed to work with HTML and CSS, it will almost certainly handle JavaScript like a pro. So stick with that. If you don't know where to start, I'm going to suggest Sublime Text. That's what I'll be using personally for all of the coding examples you see in this course. Technically, Sublime Text is not free, but you can download and install it, run it, and use all its features indefinitely. Paying for it removes the occasional pop-up that it throws up, reminding you that it's not free. Now, Sublime Text is a project-based editor, but creating a new project is a bit unintuitive. So let's just go through it. If you have a project currently open, close it via the project menu, Close Project. Then select Project Save Project As, and browse to a folder you want to store your project, and give the project file a name. Finally, select Project Add Folder to Project, and add the folder where you stored your project. Once you add a folder to the project, the sidebar will open, showing you all the files in your project. Sublime will start you out with an empty document. Save that, giving it the name index.html. Make sure you save it in your project directory. Now, because this is an HTML file, Sublime will enable some special HTML features. Type in the letters HTML and hit the tab key. Bingo, you have an HTML document all ready for you to enter the title. If you go into the head section and type link and hit tab, it will create a style sheet link tag ready for you to enter the href. Similarly, if you enter script and hit tab, it will create a JavaScript tag that you can then either enter a source attribute or just start writing some code. Also, notice how the various elements and attributes are color-coded. You see the same thing for CSS files and JavaScript files. If you don't like the colors it's using, you can go to the Preference menu, select Color Schemes, and choose one of the many built-in color schemes. Or if you want to go really crazy, you can create your own scheme. I'll be using the default color scheme and fonts for this course. Now, the other tool you need is a browser. As I said, your operating system comes with a browser pre-installed, but you'll most likely want to install a couple more so that you can test things out in different browsers. Minimally, Google Chrome and Mozilla Firefox. But if you've done any HTML work, I'm telling you stuff you already know. I'll be using Chrome for this course. It works well and has a very nice set of developer tools that will help you inspect your code while it's running and track down and fix any bugs. We'll be covering those tools in the next section, so I strongly suggest that for the purposes of this course, you should stick to Chrome as the browser that you use to test your examples with. That way, we'll both be on the same page. But I want to wrap up this section by discussing where you should actually put your code. There are three main options, and they're all very similar to where you would define CSS styles for a web page. For the rest of this section, I'll be writing and testing real code in an editor and a browser. If JavaScript is very new to you, I urge you to stop the video, open up your editor of choice, or install Sublime Text, and follow along with what I'm doing. But if this is just review for you, feel free to just watch for now. The first option is called inline JavaScript. You'll see this most often to deal with events like button clicks. Let's go over to that index.html document we just created. Go down to the body section and add a button element. In Sublime, I can just type button and hit the tab key. Then I'll give it some text to display. Now I want something to happen when I click on this button, so I'll add an onClick attribute and assign a text string to it. That text will be actual JavaScript code. Let's call up an alert box with the text Hello World in it. So I type onclick equals quote alert hello world. Now I can launch this file in Chrome, and you can see that it created that button. When I click on the button, the JavaScript I wrote is interpreted and executed. The alert box is displayed with the message I gave it. So this works, but you almost never ever want to do something like this. It's very much the same thing as using inline styles. We could add a style attribute to this button and say color colon red. And as expected, you'll see that this changed the color of the text on the button to red. But you would probably never do that for styles either. Say you wanted all your buttons to have a certain style, which included red text. But later someone decided that they should have a slightly different shade of red. If you used inline styles, you'd have to hunt down every instance of every button that was styled this way and change them one by one. It's the same for code. Sites can get large with many HTML files and all kinds of complicated code controlling it all. You don't want to be scanning through HTML file after HTML file, trying to find inline scripts. It's much better to centralize all your code the same way you would centralize all your styles. So the next option is the script tag. This is equivalent to a style tag in an HTML page. With a style tag, you write all your CSS inside that tag and it gets applied to anything on that page. With a script tag, you write JavaScript code right inside the script tag and it gets executed when the page loads. Back in the code, I'm going to clear out all the button attributes I created before and give this button an ID of btn. Then I'm going to add a script tag right below this. Now you might be used to seeing script tags up in the head section of an HTML document, and yes, that's normally where you'd see them. I'm going to put this one after the button because the document is going to load it in the order it's written, and I want the button to exist before I start writing code that deals with it. In lesson 3, you'll learn a lot more about this, so I wouldn't worry about it too much right now. And I'm going to write some code in here that's going to find this button via the ID we just gave it and assign a JavaScript function that will run when the button gets clicked. This will contain the same line we wrote before, alert hello world. And we can test that. And yes, the function gets called and the alert box appears. If you don't understand a single thing about the code I wrote, do not worry about it. The actual code here is not the important part. After you get through a couple more lessons, you'll understand it completely. For now, the only part I really want you to grasp is that we move the code out of the button tag and into a script tag. If we had other code that did other stuff, it would also go into the script tag. All the code for this page would go into that one tag. Then, if you needed to find the code for this page, you could go straight to the script tag and it would all be right there. So like inline styles versus style tags on a page, script tags are a huge improvement over inline JavaScript. But it's still not perfect. To see why, let's create a style tag and set a style for the button element that gives it a color of red. Great, so now every button on this page will have red text. But say we navigate to a new page within the same site. Buttons are back to normal black text. We'd have to copy this style tag into every other HTML page on the site. Then, if we want to change the color, we have to go through every single page and change that style. It's the same with JavaScript. You'll very often be creating bits of code functionality that you want to have exist on multiple pages. Copy and paste is not a viable solution for reuse. So we centralize our styles and code across the whole site. We create site-wide CSS files that are referenced by many or all of the pages in a site. And likewise, we create external JavaScript files that are accessed from any page that needs the functionality contained within that file. So back in our HTML file, I'll continue to use this script tag, but I'll delete the actual script out of it. Instead, I'll add a source attribute to it and point that to an external JavaScript file. I'll call it main.js. JavaScript files generally have a .js extension by convention, but technically they could be named anything. Now, even though the script tag is empty, it's very important that you don't shortcut it like this. While that is a valid way of closing an empty tag in HTML, it won't work for linking to external JavaScript files. You need to add the full ending tag. Now I'll create this main.js file by creating a new file in Sublime Text and saving it with the name main.js in the project folder. Then I'll just write the same basic code that I had in the script tag earlier and save it again. Test that in the browser, and we're still in business. Now, hopefully this all makes sense to you because every bit of code I'm going to write for the rest of this course will be in external JavaScript files like this. I think you'll get very used to it very soon.